more on to come to this sixth dialogue between Dr. Marc Gafni and Andrew Cohen. Marc and Andrew will talk about the evolution of spiritual community and leadership. And with that, Krista, I would encourage you to introduce Marc to everybody that probably doesn't know Marc yet.
Thank you so much, Daniela. And it's an honor to introduce to all of you Dr. Marc Gafni. Marc Gafni is a leading public intellectual and teacher impacting the source code of global culture. Gafni is a visionary thinker, a social activist, and a passionate philosopher. He is known for his source code teachings, including unique self theory and the five selves, the amorous cosmos, a politics of evolutionary love, a return to eros, and digital intimacy. He is author of 25 books, of which the first 10 have been published, including the award-winning Your Unique Self, The Radical Path to Personal Enlightenment. He holds his doctorate in philosophy from Oxford University, as well as Orthodox rabbinic ordination. He teaches on the cutting edge of philosophy and spirit in the West with the aim of participating in the articulation of what Dr. Gafni, together with Dr. Zach Stein and colleagues, are calling a cosmo-erotic humanism. At the core of this cosmo-erotic humanism is what Dr. Gafni and Dr. Stein are calling first principles and first values, anthro-ontology, and the universal grammar of value. This is the ground of a new shared universe story and a new narrative of identity for the new human and the new humanity. And this is what they are calling the emergence from Homo sapiens to Homo amor. This shared story, rooted in first principles and first values, can then serve as the matrix for a global ethos, for a global civilization. Dr. Gafni is the co-founder, together with Ken Wilber and Sally Kempton, of the Center for Integral Wisdom, where he serves as its co-president. And together with Zach Stein, they are co-leading a team of thinkers, articulating this new vision of meaning for the world. Previous chairs of the center include Barbara Marx Hubbard, Laurie Galperin, John P. Mackey, Carrie Kish, and Adam Bellow. And our current chairs are Sharif Melnick and Gabrielle Anwar. Marc also served as the co-chair, together with Barbara Marx Hubbard, and now as a director of the Foundation for Conscious Evolution. Together with the late Barbara Marx Hubbard, he co-founded One Mountain, Many Paths, and we come together for our weekly gathering every Sunday as a global communion of pioneering souls committed to articulate first principles, first values, a new story for a new humanity. Or as Marc and Barbara said it together, a planetary awakening in love through unique self symphonies. And all of these movements have recently come together under the Office for the Future, initiated by Barbara Marx Hubbard, Dr. Gafni, Dr. Stein, and visionary leadership partners from around the world. And with that, I turn my words back to you, Daniela.
Thank you so much, Krista. So, and I am very happy to introduce Andrew Cohen to all of you. Andrew Cohen is a spiritual teacher, author, cultural visionary, and inspirational speaker. His work has been acclaimed by luminaries worldwide, from academics to philosophers to teachers of all faiths and none. From 1991 to 2010, he was editor-in-chief of the award-winning Enlightened Next magazine, a widely cherished publication that explored the deepest existential questions of our time with some of the world's most noted thought leaders. Andrew has become known for his willingness to boldly cast aside the sacred cows of the spiritual world. His work grapples with demystifying the wealth of knowledge found in the great wisdom traditions and with making enlightenment deeply relevant to a postmodern audience. In 2020, he and a small group of collaborators launched the online project Manifest Nirvana, a virtual ashram and monastery of the future, which Andrew has called a home for sovereign souls, radical spirits, and integral pioneers. In his 3 decades of teaching and lecturing, he has developed a unique and powerful vision for a truly contemporary spirituality, combining evolutionary theory and integral developmental practice with the timeless wisdom of the perennial philosophy. Departing radically from a traditional Eastern approach, Andrew's pioneering Dharma, evolutionary enlightenment, calls not for transcendence of the world, but for a deep and heroic responsibility for its evolution. And with that, Andrew, I'm very happy to hand over to you.
Hello, everybody. Nice to see you all. I'm sorry if there are a little bit of some cracking sounds in the background, but we're in India and they're celebrating this annual holiday called Diwali. So all day we've been suffering through these enormous explosions of these immense firecrackers. So there's some of them are going on in the background. So please forgive us for that. Nothing I can do about it. I'm not that powerful. So I'm very excited to go into this topic with all of you. Marc and I wanted to talk about the significance of spiritual community in the midst of those of us who are trying to evolve beyond postmodernism. What could its role be? Why is it important? So I wanted to begin by saying, quoting the Buddha in a way that I often do, because this particular quote, this particular line that comes from the Lord Buddha, I find absolutely inspiring, compelling, and completely mind-blowing. So apparently when the Buddha was asked, is association with like-minded people a part of the holy life? The Buddha responded, association with like-minded people is not a part of the holy life. Association with like-minded people is the whole of the holy life. So to repeat, he said, association with like-minded people is the whole of the holy life. And when I heard this, it really took me aback. And I think especially now, for a while we've been living in the age of the individual. I'm a baby boomer, so the baby boomers, my generation, are the first culture that was specialized in producing narcissists. So the boomer culture, my culture, is a culture of narcissists, and we have our children, I think, have apparently become better at it than we are. So there is a big in postmodernity, and obviously in what's succeeding postmodernity, what's being called post-postmodernity or metamodernity, there is a trend or a tendency to cherish the significance of our individuality. And while that's very important, I have been feeling for quite some time that maybe it's time for us to question our over infatuation with our uniqueness, our need to be sovereign. Many of the smartest philosophers and spiritual teachers that I'm aware of this particular time in history are stressing the need for us to become, in this very confusing and complex time we're living in, are calling us to become good sense makers, learn how to make sense of our experience, and to become sovereign souls. And generally speaking, I'm hearing this emphasis on the need to learn how to make sense of our experience and the need to become sovereign souls in isolation. In other words, very little is said about the fact that we're all part and part of human culture. And what does this have to do with being part of human culture? Human culture creates the self that we all believe ourselves to be. So My intention with my spiritual life and my spiritual aspirations was always to go as far as I could. And I was always very intrigued by this notion of I was always very intrigued by the idea of awakening to a completely different dimension of reality, a dimension in which we could discover inner freedom. And more than even inner freedom, profound liberation. So when we have spiritual breakthroughs, personal spiritual experiences of revelation and transcendence, when these experiences are truly powerful and truly liberating, what usually happens is that we experience or we awaken to or become conscious of a dimension of reality that is not relative, but that's absolute. It's a discovery of absolute reality. Absolute reality in contrast with relative reality. So in relative reality, we live in a world where we have been conditioned to interpret our experience of being in this world and of having the human experience itself through the values that come to us from the culture that we grew up in. And for those of us that grew up in a postmodern cultural context and cultural environment, we grew up being told that there are no absolutes and there's no such thing as a meta-narrative and there's no such thing as absolute truth. So this creates a very challenging existential position for us because it means that there's not necessarily any inherent meaning or purpose to the human experience. And a lot of people who have grown up in the postmodern context, and a lot of millennials especially these days, are finding great trouble with this growing up in a very rich and complex world that appears apparently to be meaningless or without inherent purpose or higher value. And if this is the way we see the world, if this is the way we're interpreting our experience, it's bereft of that which is most important. So when we have a spiritual breakthrough, when we're lucky enough to experience a state of enlightened awareness or a state of enlightenment, when we have a spiritual breakthrough, we take that leap from relative reality, relative consciousness, and relative cognition to absolute reality, absolute consciousness, and absolute cognition. It's a leap to the experience of that which is relatively real, to that which is absolutely real. And when we experience that which is absolutely real, it has a different quality. It feels more real, more. Absolute reality has greater substance, greater authenticity than relative reality does. So this leap from relative reality to absolute reality is not a small shift. It's an absolute shift in consciousness and cognition and understanding and perception. So when we experience absolute reality, for those of us who are lucky enough to have that kind of experience, when we experience that shift, we realize that what we're experiencing now in this absolute context is more substantial. And when we awaken to absolute reality, we discover that in some way, shape, or other, in that kind of experience, we discover that reality and existence itself is good. We discover that there is an inherent, incalculable value to existence and to the experience of consciousness, the experience of awareness, that the conscious cognition of existence, of life, of consciousness, the consciousness of being, the consciousness of existence, we discover in the context of absolute reality, in this absolute revelation, a inherent and profound goodness, truth, and beauty. But we discover goodness, truth, and beauty in an absolute context, and an absolute context overwhelms our relative sensibilities. So it's usually a discovery of the overwhelming nature of the inherent goodness of existence itself. So we discover that to exist is inherently good. Goodness is part of the fabric of reality from its very foundations, all the way up and all the way down. And when we discover this in the context of the spiritual revelation, of this revelation of absolute reality, and we return back to relative reality, if this experience has been deep enough, we now know that existence itself is inherently good in a way that is profound beyond measure. And we can become a source of spiritual self-confidence, because as we all know, that life in the context of relative reality is confusing, frightening, to say the least, and these days more than ever. So the experiential discovery and recognition that existence itself is inherently good beyond measure can give us an anchor in a sense of profound spiritual self-confidence, which is what we all need, I think, to make it through the challenging times that are ahead. Now, when a lot of people return from having a powerful spiritual experience, unless the culture that we are, that we have come from and that we are abiding in, knows how to help us to interpret these kinds of experiences, we may not know how to interpret what has happened to us. So modernity is based up of fundamentally materialistic values. Postmodern values, and neither modernity nor postmodernity recognizes the significance of consciousness or the significance of deep interiority. So if we've had a liberating experience of deep interiority and we are still fundamentally identified with the values that come from modernity and postmodernity, which are materialistic, we won't know what to do with what's happened to us, and we may even begin to doubt its validity. Now, I believe that the reason that the Buddha made this comment that the whole of the holy life is association with like-minded people is because when we associate with other human beings that give the greatest value to the spiritual experience or the highest revelation of the awakening to enlightened awareness, it's awakening from relative truth to absolute truth, relative reality to absolute reality, and we are in association with other friends and peers who have the same conviction, then with their help and in the context of co-creating culture together, we can begin to make sense of what we have seen and what we've recognized and what we've known. Now, I was someone who never wanted to go back to the way things were. I wanted to continue to move forward. And when I had my awakening experience, when I met my guru in 1986, I wanted my life and the rest of it to be an expression of making sense out of that experience. I never wanted to go back to relative reality. So the deepest kinds of spiritual revelation, especially in history's greatest realizers, has always had a great effect on cultural evolution. And so the reason that we need to create culture together based on these deep realizations is because the shared values of postmodern culture and even post-postmodern culture very much need the presence and the influence of these higher insights and these deeper dimensions of what's real, these deeper interpretations of what's real. There's no world that exists outside the world that we co-create together with our shared values. So from a certain point of view, I think we could say that the greatest significance of these higher state experiences is to help us, to guide us in the direction of how we can co-create a more evolved cultures together. Culture is the world that we create together. And traditional values are insufficient for this particular time in history. Modern values are insufficient. Postmodern values are so insufficient. We need to move forward together. And we need to be able to move forward with great conviction. And that conviction can only come from us from the direct revelation of spirit itself. And when we can begin to share that conviction with each other, we can create the foundations for creating a new culture together. And of course, there's always an inherent problem when we're co-creating culture. Mark and I can go into what these problems are, have been. When we're doing something big, it's always dangerous. But I think that the most important part of the spiritual experience and the spiritual path is very much all about creating culture, not just for you and me, but for all of us. It's making sense out of the human experience at the highest level. So can we aspire to make sense out of the human experience at the highest level, not for ourselves, but for all of us? That's what we need now more than ever, is to make sense out of the human experience. Hi, Mark. Oh, there you are. You're at the bottom of my screen.
You're muted, Mark.
There we go. It's good to see you, man. Yay.
Yeah, you too.
Yeah, totally. Totally, totally. And by the way, I apologize to everyone for the first few minutes. I didn't notice that my picture wasn't on. So I flipped it on in the middle, but I've of course been with you here since 11. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Andrew. Thank you so much, Daniela and Krista, for setting up the space And I'm just delighted to be here in the dialogue. We're now at about 1125, 1127. And, you know, as you all know, the way we set up a dialogue is, I see a couple people checking their watch, they're in different time zones. What time is it? It's about 1127, 1128. And Andrew and I kind of take, you know, 15 minutes or so in the beginning, each of us to try and, as Andrew just did, to kind of set the widest frame, the widest context. And then from there, you know, dive into the big invitation. So what I'd like to do is Andrew set a, and thank you so much, Andrew, set a very wide context. And I want to actually meet him. We were actually texting this morning about who was going to begin. So since he began with a kind of wide context, I want to really meet you, Andrew, in that, you know, wide context, brother, and kind of set that up with you together. And then as you suggested, we can then go into, well, how do we create community? Right? What does community look like? Right? What does leadership look like? What are the challenges to leadership? Why is leadership and community so threatening in postmodernity? Right? Why is that almost a problem by itself? But let's put that aside for a second, everyone. We'll get to that part two and just kind of step in. So first, it's just so good to be here. Good morning. Hello. Yeah, can we just raise everyone's hands? Let's get some energy. Let's feel everybody here. Okay. Hello. Good morning. Yay. India, right? Miami. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. It's just a huge yes. A huge yes to this conversation. A huge yes to being alive together. A huge yes to being in community together, right? In this moment. And this moment's not a given, right? This moment never existed before. This moment never was. And the quality of this moment and what we can create in this moment, right, together is immeasurable. So I just want to feel that with you, right? We're right before, right, the inception of everything. And then the Big Bang just happened, and all of the energy that incepted the Big Bang and that burst creativity beyond imagination is quite literally moving through us in this moment, which is as unique as that moment. And so let's explode something. Let's create something new, right? Let's evolve culture and consciousness for real together. And what Andrew, what you pointed to so beautifully, right, as always, is that in the evolution of culture, we actually have to evolve culture, meaning how do you create culture, right? How do you create community? And what is community? So let's start, you know, in the middle. It's always a good place to start, okay? There are two qualities that live in consciousness, and they live side by side, right? Hans, how you doing over there, right? Two qualities, yes, right? Two qualities in consciousness, they live side by side. One quality is, as Andrew, you said so beautifully, the sovereign person, the unique person. Right? And you might even say the separate person, because separation exists in the mind of God. Right? There's right here I am. There's Mark. Right? There's my friend Sally. Right? There's Shahat. Right? There's Tom. Right? We exist. We're here. So there's autonomy. Right? Autonomy is real. The sovereign person is real. And at the same time, there's a second quality. And the second quality is communion. And communion is real. And the urgent need for the autonomous individual to realize the fullness of him or herself in the context of larger communion, right, is one of the core qualities of reality, right? And when that doesn't happen, we have a name for it. We call it loneliness, right? We call it loneliness, right? That feeling that from all my sovereignty, right, I feel lonely, not just alone, right? Right? It's not just alone. It's not just an experience of functional individuation in which I experience my separateness. I actually feel lonely. I feel like there's something wrong with the universe, right? Open up, for example, let's go to a sacred text, the book of Genesis, and in the ancient Near East, which still resonates throughout the world in many beautiful ways. And so the book opens with, and God saw that it was good. Right? And God saw that it was good. And it's a recurrent refrain. Okay? And if we were Bible Belt fundamentalists, we'd get this going on in a real way. And God saw that it was good. Hallelujah. No takers here? We're not going to pass? No? Okay. We won't do that now. Okay? So God saw that it was good, right? God saw that it was good. It repeats and repeats and repeats and repeats. And then in chapter 2, the literary refrain that Milton points to as being so important, God saw that it was good, it was good, it was good, right? Crescendos into the verse, it's not good, which appears only twice in the entire literary text of the great canon, right, called the Bible. It's not good. So after all of the ketov, 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 it's good, it's good, it's good, lotov, it's not good. What's not good? What's not good? Lotov heyot ha'adam levado. It's not good for the human being to be alone, and a careful reading of the text, right, translates it as lonely. Right, lonely. Wow. That's loneliness, meaning the experience of the sovereign person independent of the larger field of intimate communion, is a violation of the core quality of the good. Wow, right? I mean, that's not minor, right? That's not a detail, right? Tamu uru kitov Adonai is Aquinas's favorite verse in the sacred text, and it's taste and see. Taste, right? It's a radical experience. Andrew, what you talked about the move to the absolute, to radical cognition and the radical goodness of reality. But it's not just an intellectual experience, it's a taste. Taste and see that God is good, right? Writes David in Psalms. But that goodness can only be experienced fully when I'm in the dialectical dance of my life and my personal life between my radical autonomy, my sovereignty, my vision, and when I realize that uniqueness is not the same as separateness. Uniqueness actually is not the currency of alienation, but uniqueness is the currency of connection. That my uniqueness is a puzzle piece that inexorably, animated by Eros, moves me to become part of a larger puzzle. Right? And if I have an experience of being a separate self, meaning I'm a puzzle piece just kind of walking along trying to find my way, and I'm told to affirm my sovereignty, the puzzle piece is crooked and kind of bounces and can't quite find its way because everyone's telling me there's no larger puzzle. And if you've ever seen a puzzle piece, it's kind of hard to walk that way, right? It doesn't work, right? So separate self doesn't work without a larger context. But then when I go to true self, right, I go to the experience of the radical absolute, the radical oneness, true self is falsely read in many of the texts of the great tradition in a limited way. It's a true but partial meaning. It's limited. True self is classically read, and I was just talking to my friend Daniel about this. We had a long conversation. True self is classically read as the realization of the absolute in which I'm in complete oneness. That's not what true self is. That's not right. True self is two things. True self is the experience of oneness. I'm one with the field, but true self is at the same time, and this is critical, and it's life-changing if we get it. True self is the experience of the invisible lines of connection that animate the field at every level, right? So true self is the actual experience, right, of all of the lines of interconnectivity and interpenetrated essence, right? When I actually realize that I don't exist without the Higgs boson field, without the fungi, right, in a particular part of the ocean, I can't breathe, right? When I actually have a lived experience, that actually I don't exist without the whole, that there's no such thing as an individual, that the actual notion of individual per se, independent of larger communion, is a lie. It doesn't exist, right? Erotic communion is the nature of reality. Erotic communion doesn't efface the individuated self. Right, erotic communion includes radical individuation. And we have to evolve the nature of our individuation from separateness to uniqueness, from separate self to what we call unique self, right? The higher individuation beyond ego, from which place I participate in unique self symphony. Right, I move from the images of the instrumentarian collective, right, evoked by psychosocial techno engineering, right, from the social hive, right, into the unique self symphony. And the movement from that one image to the next is essential to the evolution of culture that Andrew and I want to talk about and taste here together, right? Is this movement from the social hive to unique self symphony, right? Is this sense of communion when I actually, for the first time in my life and friends, I actually transcend my loneliness, right? Just let's look around the room today, right? We're all sitting alone in different places, right? After COVID, and we might be alone someplace, and you know, and some people are with one or two other people, but most people are alone, right? Most people are alone, and even if I'm with someone, I might be radically alone, but most of us, right? Most of us are alone in some fundamental way in the world, and there's a fundamental experience of loneliness, right? And if we actually tapped into, right, the underlying current, even on this phone call, we were actually willing to own it, because we're willing to own a lot of things, but not loneliness, right? People own, right, all sorts of, you know, misdeeds, some which are they accurately own, and others they inaccurately own because it's part of the style of certain cultures, right? But we're willing to own lots of things. People aren't willing to own their radical loneliness, right? We're almost shamed. Isn't that true, friends? Right? Who knows? Just anyone, show of hands. Who knows what we're talking about, right? Right? Who knows, right? Right? We're not willing to own that radical sense of loneliness, right? Like, wow, it's not good for the human being to be lonely. And that experience of lonely rips my heart apart. And we have this yearning, what Deschardin wrote about, this sensual yearning to participate in intimate communion with each other in a higher vision, in a higher vision. You know, my friend and colleague and one of the original founders of the Center for Integral Wisdom is Sally Kempton. She's a great teacher of Kashmir Shaivism. And she told me a story about her dad. And her dad's Murray Kempton, who was kind of, I don't know if you people who know American journalism, kind of the premier American journalist, him and Bill Buckley for 40, 50 years. You know, kind of wrote a column every day, you know, was kind of a major iconic figure, right, in the American political world and in world politics. And, you know, when Murray was at the end of his life, he was talking to Sally about that the experiences that he yearned for, right, that these were the, right, the apex experiences, right? Right, you know, what Maslow called peak experiences, but we're gonna rewrite as not P-E-A-K, but P-E-E-K, peak, right? You could see into something, right? Something was available there, right? And he recalls as one of his experiences, friends, he recalls, right, his service in the war in the Japanese theater of World War II, which was brutal. Brutal, and life is on the line every second, right? Friends dying around, right? It was just this brutal. And Sally says, what? Why are you, and Murray was very much, you know, very much not a warmonger. He was a classical liberal. He was all about peace, right, in communion. Right, so Sally says, you know, Dad, right, Murray, like, what do you mean? And he said, I felt community. We were together. We had each other's back, right? We had a vision. We had a clear purpose, right? We knew where we were going. We mattered to each other infinitely. We loved each other madly. Wow, right? So we know how to come together when we need to in our war rooms. You know, my dear friend, an evolutionary partner and a dear friend of Andrew and Sally and Barbara Marx Hubbard and I did some beautiful dialogues right before Barbara passed, right? Barbara used to talk about a peace room. And I love evoking Barbara Marx Hubbard. I miss her. And I love sharing her. And so Barbara used to talk about a peace room. And what she meant intuitively was, can we come together with that same sense of urgency, Andrew, what you like to call ecstatic urgency, right? For the sake of the evolution of culture and consciousness, and for the sake of transcending our loneliness, right, and actually finding the intention of reality, which is communion, we cannot evolve culture and consciousness. We cannot participate in the evolution of love as sovereign individuals. We can't pose, right, as we often do, and even the spiritual teacher community does, right? We speak the language, but it's really individuals, right, commodifying their lists and selling and pushing and, right, and there's an entire kind of egoic, I don't want to say male egoic, because there's feminine and male egoic, which are pretty much the same at lower levels of consciousness. It's not masculine and feminine. We don't need more feminine values. We need more feminine and masculine values at higher levels of consciousness, right? So, but it's often, even in the spiritual teach community, is often feminine, masculine jousting for position, right? Commodifications of the ego self, but just selling a different product. What does it mean? And I'll finish here, and I'm watching the time, and I want to be aligned with Andrew just in time frames. So I'm just going to go for, you know, another minute and a half, right? But just to kind of feel this together, what would it mean to be unguarded together, right? To create not just a covenant of fate, right? But a covenant of destiny, where we have a shared vision. And just like Murray was in the Japanese theater, we're back to back. We've got each other's back. We're willing to love each other madly, what we call to love each other outrageously. Meaning it's not romantic love, right? It's the love that moves the sun and other stars. It's the love that's the heart of existence itself, that moves through us as a community. And as Rumi said, you can only be sane with mad love. To actually love each other madly for real, to hold each other, right? In that deep way of intimate communion, and then to move together as a community. Now, let me just say one thing, and then I'll with great delight turn to my dear friend Andrew. Of course, there's dangers in strong community. There's dangers in strong religion. There's dangers in strong sexuality, right? There's dangers in strong liberalism, right? There's dangers in strong, right? Anything that appears in a strong form has danger. Of course it does. But we don't dismiss medicine because of the dangers of medicine. We don't dismiss, right, sexuality because of the dangers of sexuality, right? We don't dismiss community because of the dangers of community. We navigate community. So I'll end with this. The community we're talking about always has to be transpersonal and not prepersonal. Right? Prepersonal, level one. The cult is prepersonal. Right? The baby is prepersonal. We then individuate into the personal. Right? Separation, appropriate boundaries, right? Appropriate, right? Self-construction, as we say in egoic terminology, in the best sense of self-construction. And then that's level two. Then we move to level three, the transpersonal, which includes all of the boundaries of the personal and yet re-embraces, right, that which is beyond. Right? It's not the pre-personal. It's not the merging. It's not the abandonment of self. It's the full personal individuated self who then steps into, transcends and includes all of the individuation into this larger field of intimate communion in which I'm a full unique self. I'm an irreducible unique self, and yet I'm part of a unique self symphony. So just as I hand the baton back to Andrew, can we just feel that inside of us? We can't think this, as Andrew said, we gotta feel it. What would it mean to actually be radiant, playing my instrument in the unique self symphony, knowing that I'm in the full sensual power, borrowing Desjardins' term, of my instrument, that my instrument is ultimately needed by the entire symphony, and yet feeling everyone playing around me, and in this full and larger radiance, right? That is the only way forward. That's the only response which is adequate to this moment in time. So that's the frame, just to kind of create a frame together. And Andrew, with delight, I turn back to you.
Thank you, Mark. So first of all, I wanted to respond to what you said about loneliness.
Yeah.
When we experience loneliness, it's the experience of separation. And the ego can experience loneliness, and does. The ego is lonely. But But when we discover our true self or our authentic self, when we awaken to, we take this leap from relative reality to absolute reality, we recognize that the loneliness was unreal. And then actually from an absolute point of view, from an absolute non-relative point of view, we never were lonely, we never could be lonely, because reality itself, as you were making clear, is entirely connected at the macro level, at the micro level, in multiple dimensions all at the same time. So if we're conscious of who we are and what we are and all its multidimensionality and multiplicity, how could we ever be lonely? I'm looking for you on the screen. I can't see you.
I'm right next to you on my screen. We're right next to each other.
Oh, okay.
How many fingers?
I'm feeling lonely if I can't see you.
Okay, so, 3, 2.
So that's one point. So if we're experiencing loneliness, it means we're not fully conscious. We're not conscious of who we are and what we are and what's the true nature of the self and all of its multiple dimensions. Now, you brought up this story about Sally's father and his experience during wartime. And I've often spoken about that in my own teaching work. Now, so many soldiers who come back from the battlefield where there's been so much gruesome fighting, so much death and so much pain and horror, despair. We've heard described what you were speaking about is that men say, "I've never felt so alive in my life. I've never been so alive. I never felt so connected to other human beings. I've never felt so alive, and I've never felt so connected to other human beings." And I think the reason for that is because on the battlefield, we find ourselves in an absolute context, because death is ever present. The immediacy and the immediacy of death is so ever present, it wakes us up. And when we have a group of people who have awakened to the immediacy of death, they take that leap from relative reality and relative consciousness to relative cognition to absolute consciousness, absolute reality, and absolute cognition. And that's what makes this otherwise terrible human experience into a terrible human drama of war and battle into an ecstatic experience of an ecstatic revelation. So, as I was speaking about earlier, this leap from relative reality and relative consciousness and relative cognition to absolute reality, absolute consciousness and absolute cognition reveals to us the ultimate mystery that transcends life and death, and the ultimate nature of reality itself, which is so indescribably positive, more positive than positive could even mean or imply. And as you have been describing, and as you always do when you speak, Mark, this, that kind of experience and that kind of revelation calls the realizer to share it. All great realizers are compelled to share this miraculous truth that they have recognized and understood, because the truth wants to be known. Consciousness is always seeking for itself. An awakened consciousness is always seeking for itself in the other or in the others. So it seems to me, and this is continuous in my experience, that absolute reality, once it has found us, is seeking to find others. Because it wants to be known, and it wants to be acknowledged. And it wants to be worshipped and adored and cherished by all of us. So as we know, many of us think when we're at the beginning of the path that we're seeking for absolute reality, we're seeking for the love of God. But if we're lucky enough to find it, we realize that love has been seeking for us the whole time. And so when the Buddha said, "The whole of the holy life is association with like-minded people," it's so that this miraculous revelation of absolute reality can be shared and can be known and can be cherished, adored and worshipped by all of us. And when it does, that's when religion is born, the essence of what religion is all about, which is in some shape or form a revelation of higher reality or absolute reality. So the reason I'm stressing this, as I was saying, is what I was speaking about earlier, is that in this age of autonomy and sovereignty, and I appreciate how necessary it is for us all to become sovereign souls and autonomous sovereign souls, so we don't get duped, so we don't get brainwashed, so we don't start believing conspiracy theories, get lost in the madness that everybody seems to be so lost in. We need to become sovereign souls, because if we're not a sovereign soul, it means we're not a sovereign thinker. And if we're not a sovereign thinker, we're going to believe what other people tell us is true, or what other people we think know better than us. We won't be thinking for ourselves about what's true. So we have to learn to be sovereign, but it's not enough. It's not enough to be happy, it's not enough to be free, and it's not enough to liberate our souls. So the simple point I'm trying to make is that, as the Buddha made clear in his statement, inherent in the evolutionary impulse and in the spiritual impulse is the desire to seek for communion with other sovereign souls and other sentient beings. It's part and parcel of the holy life, of the spiritual life. It's inherent in it. So the search for enlightenment, the search for religious fulfillment and fullness is the search for communion. And one of the things I've been speaking about a lot with my spiritual soul partner here, Daniela, is we're speaking a lot about the fact that when the self wakes up, you were saying, Mark, to make the transition from the ego to the true self, or the leap to the transpersonal, the self that we realize ourselves to be in this transpersonal state of consciousness, what I call the authentic self, what you call the unique self, is that the unique self, or the authentic self, which has transcended the ego already, is yearning for communion, or oneness with other unique selves and other authentic selves. And it's a yearning for a communion that's not personal, it's a yearning for a transpersonal communion. So when we realize that the search for oneness with the other and the others is at higher levels of transcendental development doesn't come from the ego, but comes from the awakened true self, unique self and authentic self, the unique self and the authentic self themselves are searching for communion, we can see that inherent in the structure of the cosmos is this unquenchable thirst for communion. So there's a personal desire to be together with the other and the others, and there's a transpersonal desire to be together with the other and the others. And the transpersonal desire to be together with the other and the others is a deeply religious impulse. It's a deeply religious aspiration. And it's an aspiration that we experience in a part of ourselves that's not personal, but that's transpersonal. So to repeat, that means that the universe itself is trying to come together with itself at higher and higher levels of consciousness development. And this is what I continue to find in my own experience. And as I continue to teach, I can feel that inherent in the spiritual impulse and the evolutionary impulse is this desire to come together with more and more sentient beings at higher and higher levels of human potential. So what I'm trying to share with everybody is that this desire in and of itself is not personal at higher levels, and has nothing to do with the ego. It's built into the fabric of the cosmos. And when we recognize that, and when we have the courage, the spiritual courage and the spiritual self-confidence to not resist it, but to surrender to it, it becomes empowered within us, and we become like magnets. We begin to attract other people to ourselves like bees to honey. And this is what the universe itself wants to happen at these higher and higher levels. And one more thing is that this transcendental desire for cosmic unity inherently threatens the status quo of the cultural context that we've come from. So this transcendental higher aspiration for cosmic communion transcends challenges, the modern and postmodern identification and attachment to egoic sovereignty and independence. So the search for transcendental, transpersonal union and communion inherently threatens and challenges our modern and postmodern conditioning. That's why a lot of people feel higher spirituality and spiritual experiences are threatening, because they do threaten the status quo, because we're being called to a deeper, to a relationship with reality that's so much deeper and so much more informed. And so much more, and we discover that reality, that built into the fabric of reality are currents and awakened movements of intelligence that are calling us to higher and higher, to embrace reality at higher and higher levels, in ways that are completely different than what we've been taught and what we've been told. So after we have awakened, after we have deeply awakened, after our ego has been slain, when we're fully worshiping our Lord, we find ourselves in a mysterious position, in a position where we are find ourselves desperate to include all sentient beings in this miraculous realization of cosmic unity. I suppose that's how God feels, if I'm allowed to say that. I don't know if I can, but because that's what the evolutionary impulse wants. That's what it's thirsting for. That it's what it's desperate for, all of us to come together in this mutual recognition of who we all are, so we can all rejoice and co-create the future together.
You're muted, Mark.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And Andrew, I want to find you on the screen now. So you just disappeared. Where'd you go?
I'm right next to you.
There you are. Okay. Yay. Right. So this is, we don't want to be lonely. So, let's dive in here. I really want to get to, before we finish, Andrew, kind of a broader conversation about how spiritual leadership and community relates to postmodernity. But I'm going to put that aside for a second, because I want to go back and forth with you. I'm going to take a few minutes kind of in our style and our format to actually, you know, in a completely, you know, madly loving way, like we always do, take issue with 4 or 5 points, right, that you made, because I think this is where we have contrasting views of this. We share an enormous shared matrix, but I think we think about these things in a different way, which I think is actually illuminating. And I think actually impacts both the nature of community and leadership. So I think it's an interesting and fun conversation. So I jotted a couple of notes as you were chatting to kind of, you know, be able to kind of play in this together, but play in the sense of homo ludens, right? The highest sense of, you know, sacred play for the sake of the evolution of consciousness.
Sure, great.
Yeah, total. No, it's total. This will be total fun, but in the highest level of kind of evolutionary fun, right? You know, creativity. And let's see if we can find this. So let me just start with the first statement, right? Where you said that if you're really awakening into true self, you're not going to be lonely anymore. So I couldn't express more emphatically how much I disagree with that, right? In other words, I think it's wrong, you know, kind of conceptually, existentially, and psychologically, right? On all three grounds, right? And I think you actually said that was true 4 sentences later, because what you said is that, you know, once the absolute finds one of us, the absolute's looking for the rest of us, right? Right? Meaning the absolute is lonely, right? Right? And paradoxically, there's a dimension of divinity, right? Which actually is lonely, right? There's the lonely God. Plotinus talks about the lonely one, right? Seeking the lonely one, right? You know, in Kabbalah, there's this beautiful expression of, right, in Leviticus chapter 25, it talks about Gerim v'toshavi matemi madi, you are strangers with me. So God says, I'm the lonely stranger, and I'm going to look for you, the other lonely stranger, and let's be together, right? And but the idea is, let's leave the metaphysics for a second, is that loneliness exists, right, in the mind of God, right? And that we can't actually, in a certain sense, shame people for loneliness, because loneliness is actually a genuine existential experience. And I would wager, and I know we're going to disagree on this, which is great, so it's a fantastic conversation, but I'd wager that Ramana was lonely. And I don't believe it for a second, right? When anyone's going to tell me he wasn't, right? You know, in other words, in all the descriptions I've heard, both the people I've known best who were realized masters and the people who knew realized masters best, right? They all experienced this movement between full realization, right? Absolutely at home and rested in the cosmos, and loneliness, right? And so this loneliness, right, is built into the fabric of the cosmos, and it's what moves divinity to manifest reality, right? In other words, divinity moves to manifest realities because there's a drive within the infinity of intimacy for intimacy itself. Now, you're absolutely right, dear friend, that these words can't be spoken, meaning in some sense they make no sense, right? In other words, how can they have, right? I get that, right? Right? In other words, from a purely meta-theoretical perspective, right, as Maimonides points out and Aquinas points out and all of, you know, neti-neti thinkers, right, of the East point out, right, the absolute is obviously not lonely. Shut up, Mark. But yet, right, we actually can feel God, right? We participate in divinity. And that loneliness that lives inside of us is not just a separate self-pathology of personality, right? It's actually the personhood of cosmos alive in us, yearning for communion as not a pathology of cosmos, mythologize, don't pathologize, but as actually the great sacred intrinsic structural nature of cosmos. So that's one. And I think that's it. I'm going to just say a couple more things. I think that's hugely important. And the second thing, and it relates to the second thing, which is, right, the yearning for communion that we have is not a yearning to move beyond the personal. And this is another place where we've danced over the years, but in the way you presented it, right, which was so beautiful, like everything you present is so beautiful, but you present, right, this notion that we're going to kind of become part of true self, but that our yearning for communion, as you said a few times, is not personal. Right, it's a yearning for communion with the absolute. So the way I experience it, both in my own realization and the way I experience it in terms of kind of meta theory, kind of in both, is that actually there's a personhood of cosmos. I was talking to our friend Howard Bloom. I was talking to him, Andrew, about the personhood of protons, right? There's a personhood in the entire field. The entire field is personal, right? So there's an impersonal and a personal, but there's a personal that's beyond the impersonal, which is, of course, exactly what uniqueness is. That's what unique self is. It's personal beyond the impersonal. And we never move beyond the personal, right? Right? You know, we may get to that place in Kashmir Shaivism, which is duality, non-duality, right? So you might call it the personal, impersonal, right? So I can hold that with you. But actually, I think in terms of both leadership and community, any notion that there's a possibility to move beyond the personal, right, is fundamentally needs to be challenged. Now, I think we can need to move beyond the personality, right? There we completely agree. We can move beyond the personality, but the quality of the absolute is personal. Now, you point out, right, you know, I think beautifully, which would seem to challenge what I'm saying, is that actually we want to participate in the movement of cosmos itself moving towards larger union. So that's absolutely true and something that we deeply share. But here's the big however, which is, there's continuity and discontinuity at every level of cosmos. So there's matter, life, and mind, right? And you know, there are lots of people today in kind of postmodernity, let's say speciesism, which kind of says there's absolute continuity, right? And you know, in other words, and we've always emphasized discontinuity, right? The Western world emphasized discontinuity, so now there's a movement towards continuity, right? You know, for example, you know, our friend Sean gave a talk on how 9 major human characteristics are also shared by animals. But Sean went too far, because actually there's also discontinuity between humans and animals. There's always continuity and discontinuity, right? And so there's continuity and discontinuity in the way we experience loneliness, right? In other words, the proton seeking the electron is one movement of the lonely one seeking the lonely one, right? And then at the animal, right, the level of plants it emerges, and then at the level of animals, the level of mammals, then two lobsters walking together as they do monogamously, right, you know, kind of in lobster land, right, which is why don't eat lobsters. God, what are you doing, right? But that's a separate issue, right? I don't want to go there right now, right? But when human beings, right, achieve, right, intimate communion, and through every structure stage of consciousness, we evolve the way we do loneliness. And the gorgeousness of the human being, right, is that I'm actually conscious evolution. I'm the conscious lonely one, right, seeking the other. Now, last sentence on this piece where we agree is you can't fulfill that loneliness in a mere romantic partnership. That's after, right? Ordinary love is not going to do it. It's a much larger yearning. Ordinary love can be an expression of the larger field. But I need to understand that my love story has to be chapter and verse in the universal love story. I'm part of the field of outrageous love, the field of evolutionary love. And if I dissociate my love story from the larger love story, it's actually rank narcissism, and my love story is going to collapse. So I think we deeply share that understanding, although we'd express it differently. But I'm moving towards the personal. I'm yearning for the personal. Right, and it's the personhood of cosmos, and the personal and the impersonal, you know, ultimately, I would say, never split with each other, right? They never split, and if we can, so I'm gonna take shorter time because I want to go back and forth. So let me throw it at you, right? You know, toss it over the net, you know, in our badminton, and love to hear what you have to say. And we can kind of try and clarify this together. It's exciting to clarify.
Sure. So let's just go through them slowly. So the first one was.
Is the experience of loneliness, right? Does it disappear?
Yeah, okay, right? Yes. So right. I absolutely disagree with you 100%.
Awesome.
So
you'll come around. I have faith. I'm you know, it's okay. I'm
teasing. Well, no, maybe not, but that's fine. It's all good. I think that as we go through the three questions you brought up, I think some of these points we actually disagree with each other, but a lot of it has to do with semantics and the way we're using the words. The way you're using the word personal, for example, is very different than the way I'm using it, and I think that probably would solve a little bit of the confusion of some of the questions. But in the way I define these terms, I make a difference between what I call true self and authentic self. In your language, it would be a difference between true self and the unique self, which is pretty similar. But in my experience, the awakening to the true self is the end, because from my point of view, in the way that I think about this, all feelings of loneliness come from the false self or the separate self. And I am distinguishing that loneliness of the false self and the separate self from what you were speaking about and what I was speaking about is God's aspiration to grow and to become more of who and what she can be. So I want to make that distinction. So in my experience of what I call true self, in the true self, there is the cognition of that which is eternal. And that which is the ground of all being, the ground of all existence. And in that state of consciousness and in the recognition, they're literally the sense or the sense of otherness either dissipates into the background or in deeper states of consciousness disappears altogether. So in that state of consciousness, there is no loneliness. Now, and I want to make a distinction between the fact that in the true, what I'm calling true self, the ground of being, there is no loneliness, with what you were speaking about, I think, and what I was speaking about as this mysterious aspiration of what seems to be the aspiration of the absolute to call all separates unto itself, in the sense that consciousness is seeking for its own recognition in all of us, which to put it in mythic language, the mystery and who of what God as the absolute wants all of us to recognize her, wants to be seen. And so in my thinking about this, I wouldn't say that she's lonely, but I could accept I could accept your the way you're describing this as an expression of the loneliness of the absolute, and that makes perfect sense to me. And it's beautiful. It's not. I think about it in a slightly different way, but I could accept your way of putting it. So because the essence of God is the absolute is wherever the absolute is, there's only fullness. Nothing is missing, even though the absolute could always become more of what it could be, and it's always seeking to become more of what it could be. It's not necessarily in the core or this core, what we could call the soul or the heart of the absolute, any sense that anything's missing. Even though it's yearning to be recognized by each and all. So that's the first. And what was the second one?
It's all part of the same field, right? We can go back, it's the same. It's in the field.
Oh yeah, yeah. So the other point I think you were mentioning was this. You said that the personal exists all the way up and all the way down, I think is what you were saying in your own way, and that there's no such thing as going beyond the personal. So
the personal and impersonal at the highest level of consciousness, like Kashmir Shaivism, right? Duality, non-duality, personal.
Sure.
And
so I would beg to differ. And I noticed a long time ago, and continues to see all the time, that the personal egoic self is living in a world that's created by its own separate story. And as long as the self is captured by that story, it's living in a separate personal world. So what I was speaking about is when the ego has been transcended to a significant degree. And one is awake to what you would call the unique self, and I would call the authentic self, that I noticed in a very interesting and miraculous way that the authentic self is seeking for communion with other authentic selves, that the authentic self or the unique self that has transcended the small self is seeking for higher communion with itself in the form of the other. And in my interpretive framework and in my experience, what I'm calling the unique self or the authentic self is an expression of the self that has fundamentally transcended the personal domain, which I mean as being confined to the world of the ego. I think the way you're using the word personal is in a much deeper and more profound sense than the way I'm using it. I think that's semantic distinction is part of the what might be confusing.
Yeah, no, that's great. I mean, let's see, and this is an exciting conversation to be able to clarify this. And I love everything you said, and. You know, I don't want to say I disagree, because in a certain sense, in a conversation, if you announce a disagreement, then you're going to prove it. Let me let the agreement or disagreement come from the words I say instead of a kind of position. But of course, we share an enormous amount on this. We have an enormous amount of shared ground here. And I think the distinctions are actually helpful, beautiful. They're symphonic, right? You know, in the best sense of the word. So let me try and clarify some of the distinctions, right? Which I think are important, because we're in the same field. And one of the things I think we can model here, Andrew, is there's so much polarization. And polarization happens when people are outside of the field of value, right? When you're outside of the field of value, you're not in the field of eros, you're not in the field of consciousness, then different positions become polarizing, right? Because a person's position becomes actually a form of pseudo eros. But we're both in the field of value together, right? So in the field of value, you can have different schools of thought that dance with each other. Right, that have dinner together, that love each other madly. So we're talking here, and I just want to model, it's a different kind of conversation. We can fiercely both share and disagree, but with mad love, because we're in the field of value. We're not polarizing outside of the field. So this is very different than a kind of postmodern polarization, right? This is actually, which is a form of pseudo eros. This is an expression, this is a dance, right? Is unique self symphony by itself, right, as the instruments play. So that's our context, everyone. And that's in some sense even more important than the content. But let me now kind of turn from context, with permission, right, to content. So a couple of things, and I think it's a really big deal. So one, in every realization, right? And in every realization, we can talk about it meta-theoretically, but we can also talk about it in our bodies. You know, one text that the mystical text of the interior sciences of Hebrew wisdom love is Mipsari Echaze Eloa, in my body I vision God, right? Meaning we participate in the feeling tone of the divine. And so we can access in our own selves, right, what God's thinking and feeling, as it were, right? You know, Noah overhears God's conversation because Noah feels in himself a particular experience that lives in the divine. So from that place, I think we all have an experience at some moment, you know, whether, you know, it was, and this was not my experience, but whether for some people it was spinning at a Jerry Garcia, you know, concert as he was on his guitar, right? You know, which is one experience that people kind of lost themselves in at a certain moment in consciousness, whether it's a psychedelic experience, whether it's a meditative experience of radical, absolute, profound realization, whether it's ecstatic chant, whether it's a whirling dervish, right? Whether it's nirvikalpa samadhi, right? Whether it's, you know, bitul hayesh latocha ayin, right? The nullification of the existence into the absolute field of void, emptiness, non-existence. We can access that. I mean, and even on, you know, Friday night as I'm chanting and I get lost in a chant with my friend Sharif and Gabriel and KK, right? It's all perfect, right? There's no loneliness, right? In that moment, it's right. So there's a moment like that where it's utter perfection. And I'm sure you have that moment in your realization, in your experience, and, you know, and we both have it historically and we have it in an ongoing way. And yet that moment lives dialectically, right? Intentionally. So it's not a mistake of cosmos, right? It intentionally lives dialectically the way the mystics say it in the interior sciences of the Zohar. They say, v'chayot ratzo v'shov, right? The vitality of reality is dialectical, right? And it's at the same moment, I have this yearning for union. I have this yearning for communion, right? I have this loneliness, which is not just the loneliness of the separate self, seeking a temporary salve, right? In a ordinary love relationship, which confuses genuine eros with security and status. No, it's not that. Right? I actually participate in the yearning of the lonely one, right, for the larger communion that awakens in me personally. So actually, let me try and say it, you know, kind of radically. Reality desires the quality of Mark's loneliness, and reality desires the quality of Andrew's loneliness, and the quality of Andrew's loneliness is not the same quality of Mark's loneliness. And they're both desired by cosmos because each one is an expression of a different face of the individuated divine that experiences shocking self-recognition in the nature of Andrew and Mark's loneliness. And so those are intended experiences, right, of reality that reality never wants to move beyond and can't move beyond in the manifest reality. And let me try and add to it with permission, friend, right? There's no true self in the manifest world. There is no true self in the manifest world. It doesn't exist. Right? There's no true self without unique self, ever. Never exists. And that's the difference between true self and authentic self. Authentic self is an awakened impersonal function, as you describe it so crazy elegantly in what I think is one of the best books written, right? You know, Evolutionary Enlightenment, which is a fantastic book, right? And, you know, as I respond in this book, Self, right? What unique self says is that this higher level of realization beyond true self always has a personal dimension, that you never move beyond it, and that they live together with the impersonal. So I'd hold them together, and I would do the same thing, friend, with, try and say it this way, right, with story, right? In other words, story and non-story are one, right? You know, in other words, this experience of story is not just my egoic story, right? It's not just, right, my separate self story, but actually, reality itself is not a fact. Reality is a story. And it's not an ordinary story, it's a love story. And it's not an ordinary love story, it's an evolutionary love story, it's an outrageous love story. And my story is chapter and verse in the universal love story. And in the manifest world, it never can or should be any different, right? It never can or should be any different, right? And that's the nature, right, of the realization, right, in the manifest world, is that story and non-story are one, but cosmos itself is story, right? And so as I move beyond story, I'm moving beyond the limitations of certain levels of consciousness in story, and then story reappears at a higher level of consciousness, right? And our allurement to story is not just, you know, the ego trying to cover over the emptiness, so we're all, you know, kind of addicted to Netflix, and let's watch, you know, the 19,000th series, right? Because it actually tells me a story, right? And I have to say, I've got a, I've got to own something here, everybody. This is a big confession moment. I don't watch Netflix, but you know, Christina's been in New York for the last 3 weeks, and I spent a little more time than I wanted to with Uhtred of, you know, Benevin, I think is the name, in The Last Kingdom, and we're now in season 3. You know, so I'm tracking Uhtred's story pretty closely, just saying, just between us, right? Right, and he's taken up a little too much of my time, Uhtred, you know, but he's an incredible warrior and full honor and integrity. We love Uhtred, right? You know, but I'm attracted to story, not just because, right, Kiki's not here, I gotta fill up the time, right? It's 11:30 at night, I wanna watch it for a half hour before I go to sleep. No, I'm attracted to story because story's the structure of cosmos. And maybe last sentence and pass it back to you, brother. You know, the shortest book, you know, in Hebrew mysticism, which is also the original book, right? It's an argument in scholarship, whether it's a century before the Common Era or 2 centuries after, it's called Sefer Yetzirah, the book of creation that we once actually discussed briefly in Fox Hollow back in the day, right? It's 455 words total, right? You know, that was a time when Jews were still writing short, you know, which is not a bad idea, right? I could learn something from that. So the core play in the book is the word story, sipur. Right, it's the word story, it's the word sipur, means story, it also means book. It also means sapir, which is the blue light, which as you know, in let's say the Muktananda tradition is, right, the personal that appears as you, and you know, safar, boundary. So the point is that in this word sapir, enlightenment, sapphire, and sefer, the text of your story, the book, and sipur, story, and safar, the nature of, right, the illusion of the boundary, which also exists in the mind of God, that dialectic plays together, and we never efface it. And I guess the last thing is, Dick Mann, Sally Kempton, a whole bunch of people would tell me, you know, Muktananda says God appears in you as you, you know, and that was his, you know, his statement that he loved, and they all read it as true self. And I said, and I think it was correct, that's not what Muktananda meant. Right, you know, and I don't think it's what Kashmir Shaivism meant either. God appears in you, as Andrew, right? Andrew's not a mistake of cosmos, right? Andrewness is the intention of cosmos with his loneliness, with his beauty, right? With all of his gorgeousness, right? And there's a continuity of consciousness even to Andrewness. So that's why I would try and share it with you.
Okay, I'll try and respond briefly. Then I think it would be good if we spoke a little bit about leadership in the context of
right. I know we haven't gotten to the beginning of the topic right yet. Right, right. That's absolutely true. Yeah.
So,
right, yes. But good.
So yes, we have. I think we have a different interpretive framework that we're working with. I don't agree with you at all that Mark's loneliness is different from Andrew's loneliness. Because I think that there's only one loneliness, and when Mark experiences loneliness, he experiences Andrew's loneliness. When Andrew experiences loneliness, he experiences Mark's loneliness.
Right. Those two don't contradict each other. They can be both, just to say, right?
They don't contradict each other. But I think the experience of loneliness can either be of greater intensity or lesser intensity. But I don't think the fundamental experience of loneliness is unique to any individual or even to any other animal or sentient being. Loneliness is just loneliness.
Right. I go with both. Right. I think you can hold both together. There's a unique quality to Andrew's loneliness, even as we participate in the same field of loneliness. I think we can. There's a way to play in that. But I got you. I got you.
No, but it's an important distinction because. Yeah. Because when we begin to see that so much of the human experience is so not unique and not personal, but it's an experience, most of us are having so much of the same experience and are imagining that it tends to be very different than what everyone else has experienced. I just don't think that's actually true. And from my vantage point, when we begin to, when through introspection and reflection, we begin to recognize so much we're experiencing is what everyone else is experiencing. It pops the bubble of our preciousness and of our specialness, and it can be very liberating that we can see our experience in the context of all human experience. Mm-hmm. The other thing you said was, I think yes, what you were speaking about the story. So I think what you're saying is beautiful, because you're saying no. This because you what you're we're talking about non-duality, and these are different ways to understand the meaning of non-duality. So what you're saying right. is that you're saying that relative reality and absolute reality are one and not two.
Right. Exactly.
And I'm saying yes, relative reality and absolute reality are one and not two, and also relative reality and absolute reality are completely different than each other. There's an absolute distinction, which is that absolute distinction is what makes absolute reality so unconditionally liberating and so completely transformative. So I guess as you were just advocating, I can embrace both perspectives. I can appreciate the significance of being able to see the story and the evolution of the story and the evolution of the personal as the evolution of God in manifest existence and manifest reality, and that's beautiful and that's perfect and that's complete. And I also see, and when we wake up to absolute reality, we embrace and touch a dimension of consciousness and cognition that is utterly free from everything that's been created. And that gives us a perspective on all of manifest and creative reality that is so utterly liberating, and gives us an access to a potential for a kind of liberation that's indescribable. But I think this is a discussion we should continue to have, maybe not right now.
Yeah.
But part of it is semantics, and part of it has to do with emphasis.
Yeah. No. Totally. I just say one last thing, and I've deeply enjoyed. Right, this, you know, all of our conversations, but I think this conversation is actually wonderfully exciting and enlivening and important, you know. And so I'll leave you with this, and I think we're at 12:30, so I think we're actually we're at question time. We didn't, which is a wonderful thing in a real conversation. We didn't actually begin the actual clash of postmodernity with leadership and community and what is a higher vision of community kind of look like. We went deeply into this, you know, which is what a real spontaneous conversation, of course, is. I'll just leave you with this, you know, and then you leave us with whatever your concluding vision is. You began, and I'll conclude on the side, however it works for you, friend. But I'd say like this: once I understand that uniqueness is real, and it's an irreducible, it's not social conditioning, it's not cultural conditioning, right? Although it has a dimension of social, cultural, and psychological conditioning, that uniqueness is not reducible to social, psychological, and cultural conditioning, that uniqueness lives in the mind of God, and that we each individuate, in that individuation is the shocking divine self-recognition. And then I realized from there that Andrewness, Markness, Danielleness, Christianess, Salliness is irreducible as a unique quality of intimacy. So what I then understand from there is that Andrew's loneliness is not just our Mark's loneliness, which lives with his enlightenment, but lives with his radical realization, is not participates in the larger field of loneliness. Absolutely. And everything you said about the move from separate self to true self, which is I realize I'm not special in that separate self way. We completely agree on, as you know, we both agree on that move. But what I'm trying to share is this realization that actually in Andrew's world, in Mark's world, in our friend Ken's world, there's a unique constellation that comes from the intention of cosmos, which generates, right, a unique quality of intimate interpenetration, which therefore also generates a unique quality of loneliness. So the mother in Albania who has two children of a particular quality that never existed before, that quality never existed. And the particular quality of her intimacy with those children participates in the field of motherhood, of course, but it's also a snapshot of eternity instantiated in this unique expression, which is the non-dual expression of the divine intention of mad love, which generates as this uniquely incarnated moment, that moment's not extra. That moment has infinite dignity because it's infinitely valuable, and the quality of its loneliness and the quality of its joy and the quality of its realization, right, is utterly unique even as it participates in the whole field. So I'll leave that, you know, not for you know, I'll leave that evocation in the space. And I think it has implications politically, communally, right? I don't think it's just a meta-theoretical distinction. I think it's an important conversation, which I look forward to continuing at the right time. And yes, you know, our shared field and structure, you know, what unites us is so much greater than that which divides us here. And the clarifications here are not just fascinating, but even important, right? You know, we learn in the exchange. I've learned in the exchange. So super thank you. Super thank you. Super delight, right? Super joy for this unique quality moment of intimacy, right, between us.
Yay. So maybe we should say a couple of words about...
Yeah, totally.
That our postmodern...
Yeah.
The postmodern framework tends to flatten out distinctions and equalize all things and all people.
Yeah.
And one of the most beautiful and extraordinary and profound things about the spiritual realization is that as we wake up to verticality, we realize that the universe is expanding. And as the outer universe expands, the inner universe expands. And as the inner universe expands, consciousness itself becomes even more conscious. And we recognize that there's a distinction between being less conscious and more conscious, and even more conscious than that. And there is value, the postmodern mind wouldn't like us if we say there's greater value to being more conscious and less value to being less conscious, which I think is fairly self-evident, even though I think some people might be insulted by that. So one of the things that I find very interesting is that in a postmodern context, we can say that Mark's a better carpenter than Andrew is, and Andrew's a better drummer than Mark is. A lot of people would find that totally acceptable, or Andrew's a better father than Mark is, or Mark is a better scholar than Andrew is. And people would say, yeah, that's all just obviously true. But what a postmodern mind seems to have a lot of trouble with is if we say that Mark is more spiritually evolved than Andrew is, or Andrew's more spiritually evolved than Mark is. If the postmodern mind feels that giving spiritual development value in the context of greater value and lesser value, it often seems to be committing some kind of mortal sin, even though some people are more spiritually evolved than others. Some people are more conscious than others. Some people know more about interiority and inner depth because they spent more time on it, and they have more expertise, and they have more wisdom and experience. But in the postmodern context, we these are things that shouldn't be said, because it's almost, you're almost saying someone has a greater humanity, and you're not allowed to say someone is more human than anyone else, because that's considered to be a mortal sin. But we're not saying someone has greater humanity, we're saying someone has greater depth. And not everybody has the same experience of depth or access to the same levels of depth, and so making these distinctions is important. But if we're seeking to evolve and to develop and to grow spiritually, as some of us are actually interested in spiritual evolution and inner development, then obviously if we seek the guidance of and the help and the mentorship of people who convince us through their example that they're farther along on the path than we are, that they have more developed interiority than we do, then we can learn a lot from them. And like all fields of human development, spiritual development is no different. We need leadership, we need mentorship, we need teachers, and we need guides and people who can help us to see where we're going. And yeah, I mean, the day I met my guru, it was the day that changed my life forever. And I knew I was committed to the transformation one way or the other, and it was going to happen one way or the other. But I know that the minute I met that man, after 10 minutes, my life changed forever. It was the presence of his grace and his depth and his spiritual power and his awakened spiritual heart that was the source of my, that was and continues to be the source of my liberation. And that just happens to be the way it is. So I'm eternally in his debt, and his soul, I've come to understand, lives in a dimension beyond time, and his soul in a dimension beyond time is in communion with my soul. And of course, that doesn't make any sense to the rational mind. I sound like a lunatic, but it happens to be true. So I apologize.
Yeah, completely. Beautiful. Gorgeous. Right? And we're so together on this, and I love the way, both what you said and the way you shared it. So thank you. And we couldn't be more aligned. And I wanna dance with you and not reiterate those points in different language because you've said them so beautifully, but just to add to this, because I think it's beyond critical, right? It's beyond critical. So maybe with permission, everyone, I can, you know, for whatever reason today, I'm moved by the textual world. So I'm gonna stay for a second in the textual world. There's a story in the great mystical incarnate myth, you know, of Hebrew wisdom, of a man named Korach in the book of Numbers, K-O-R-A-C-H, worth looking up. It's one of the epic, you know, epic literary, mystical, mythical stories. And Korach challenges Moses' leadership. He says, why would you be the leader, right? Why are you doing this strong, you know, charismatic leadership thing, right? And he says, Ki kol ha'eda kula kadoshim, right? The entire congregation is holy. V'tocham Adonai, and God lives in each one of them. Madua titat nasu al kahal Adonai, and why do you raise yourself up over the congregation of God? Right? And that question, right? And there's a 2,000 year exegesis, right? And, you know, on that question. And at some point I was tempted to write a book on leadership, tracking those 2,000 years of exegesis on how you work that question. It's unbelievably important, right? And essentially the way to understand this conversation, what's the argument between Moses, right, and Korach? So Moses clearly, number one, recognizes his own imperfection. Moses doesn't claim that his prophetic capacity gives him authority across the board. Actually, the picture of Moses in this great text, this great Moses figure, is he's an imperfect vessel for the light. He makes mistakes. So let's start there. That's really important. So he's not claiming an absolute authority in every area, right? Moses is you know, has, and it's where Leonard Cohen's coming from in the song Hallelujah, right? Moses, David, these figures, right? They live in a holy and a broken hallelujah. And then there's a blaze of light in every word. It doesn't matter which you heard, right? The holy and the broken hallelujah. So Moses and David and these leadership figures live in this, they're imperfect vessels for the light. Having said that, right, Moses says, my attainment, Korach, is different than yours. And actually that's real. And Moses distinguishes between, you know, what we might call, let's make up some words now, let's call it evolutionary value and intrinsic value. Korach says we all have the same intrinsic value because of a Tocham Adonai, God lives in all of us. So how can you have any sort of hierarchy? Right? And Moses says, yes, we have the same intrinsic value. But we don't have the same evolutionary value. There's actually different levels of attainment, and that's real. Right? And my level of attainment gives me this particular quality of leadership, right, in this particular moment of time, right, which doesn't make me ultimately better than you in terms of intrinsic value. It means that my role is to be an inner physicist, right? Just like, you know, someone else's role might be to be a physicist. And then there's attainment in those, and attainment is real. And so I think the leveling of attainment, right? And we see it, you know, all the time, this leveling of differences as this movement of postmodernity, leveling of differences. And in a certain sense, what happened is, right, at one period in history, we overemphasized difference. Right, between a leader, right, and a community, between human beings and animals, right, between genders, right? There was this enormous amplification of difference in modernity, in pre-modernity and in modernity. Both had this different views of this amplification of difference, right? And I've never quite thought about it this way, but if you think about it this way in this conversation, right, post-modernity goes to level all differences, but it over mistakes on the other side in this dramatic way, and it misses this discontinuity. That actually difference is real, right? And it's only by a kind of embrace of, you know, what Rhianne Eisler, right? A great feminist writer, you know, who I had a great time with her at Passover Seder. We did Passover Seder together a little while ago, right? Called a holistic hierarchy. There's a genuine hierarchy. And hierarchy is a quality of reality. And so if we can actually liberate hierarchy from its dominator dimension, and actually recognize that we all have roles to play in the unique self symphony, right? And if the leader can actually acknowledge their Mosesness, their Davidness, the holy and broken hallelujah, right? Then the leader also is free, right, to lead. Abraham Lincoln led, right? Mother Teresa led, right? And, you know, without Mother Teresa leading her organization, they wouldn't have created this order out of the Vatican. Should we say that Mother Teresa should have just sat around the circle, right, and you know, passed the pipe and done kumbaya, right, and not created her order? Well, there would have been no order. It never would have happened. It would not have existed, right? Should Ken not have created, right, integral? That's absurd. So I think what you're saying is unbelievably important. We share it, and we desperately need that sense of this dialectical relationship between community and leadership.
Cool. Maybe we should take some questions now, brother.
Yeah, completely.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mark and Andrew. It feels like you need another session for this topic, no?
We're just getting started, and, right? We're really,
exactly. And I get a lot of messages saying, like, this needs to continue, this needs to go deeper. So it's very cool. I think people are very inspired by what you're both sharing. So let me pick the first question here, and it's from Natalie. She is asking, in the description of this talk, it is written communion where autonomy is preserved and hierarchy respected is enormous. If we can develop the methodology and the technology, it may be possible to achieve something that exceeds our wildest dreams. Please expand on methodology and technology and on hierarchy respected. Thank you.
Do you want to take that first, brother?
Yes. So the idea of autonomy and communion coexisting in the same place in the same space came to me as in the form of a spiritual realization or an insight of a glimpse into higher human potential. So usually when we experience communion with the other or the others, which means togetherness or oneness with the other and the others, we have to sacrifice a measure of autonomy or sovereignty in order to come together with the other or the others. Or if we want to achieve a level of autonomy and sovereignty, we need to remove ourselves from the experience of communion and go away from the other or the others in order to cultivate our autonomy or our sovereignty. So from an awakened non-dual perspective, it dawned on me that if we transcend the separate selves need to be separate, then we can experience the liberation of our creative unique gifts and our yearning to come together with the other and the others in the same place and in the same space. And in order for your unique creative gifts and my unique creative gifts to be able to give themselves, that I don't need to withdraw. And in that state of communion, there's no inhibition to my uniqueness, to my unique creativity, nor to yours. So my point is that autonomy and communion, if enough of the ego has been transcended, can emerge in the same place and in the same space within you, within and between unique individuals. And it's also a vision. It's a vision of the possible for the future of humanity. And along those lines, similarly, if a separate ego has been sufficiently transcended, which is a big if, we don't have any resistance to being able to appreciate the actual developmental differences that exist between us. And that's what Mark was just, I think, speaking about. Because the ego is very invested in seeing itself as being superior. We have conscious and unconscious motives to see ourselves as being better than and superior to the other. So if we've transcended that need or that desire, there's an openness and a receptivity and a sensitivity toward the awakened intelligence of our open awareness. We're able to see more clearly perceive developmental differences that exist between us and respect those differences. We're not resisting them because we're not threatened by them. So to me, a vision of the fulfillment of the promise of an evolutionary teaching is when autonomy and communion can emerge in the context of natural hierarchy. And for that to happen, all of the unique individuals involved in this experience of communion would need to be fairly developed practitioners. I mean, they have to be good ego transcenders. And if people that are good at ego transcendence come together in a state of communion, I think such a radical evolutionary potential between human beings becomes possible.
Right.
And thank goodness.
Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful. Let me pick up on a different. Natalie, it's a fantastic question. And Andrew, you introduce, there's this beautiful idea in this book of creation that the end is in the beginning is the end. So we're coming back to autonomy and communion very beautifully. So there's a sentence, dancing with what you said that I wrote a couple of years ago, all right, in a book, which is that autonomy and communion, right, the clash between autonomy and communion dissolves in ecstasy, right? Right, and I tried to write a chapter, right? In other words, in ecstasy, that clash doesn't exist. We all know that's true, right? Whether you're, whether Andrew's drumming at a rave, right? And you've got this music that's just kind of incredible, and you're in this larger field where you're both in your autonomy and you're in communion. So autonomy and communion dissolve in ecstasy. And ecstasy means, right, I'm outside of myself, and here it means my small self. I've got a larger vision, right? When we're coming together for a larger vision, then autonomy and communion can dissolve in the urgent ecstasy of the larger vision, right, which becomes a grounded political, social, moral, spiritual practice. And I think that's insanely important. And then just to take it the next step, we call this a unique self symphony, right? Natalie, you're asking about what's the methodology, right? And Andrew and I have both in very, very different ways. Andrew spent a lot of time, right, cultivating communion spaces and did some really special work in that area, right, in the Fox Hollow community. And we spent a lot of time in the community, cultivating, evolutionary we space, right, which we call unique self symphony. And in some sense, Danielle, you're absolutely right. We're actually coming to the heart of that conversation really at the end, right? That's really the beginning of a very big and large conversation. So let me just say just a very, 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 very short word on it. So the question that, Natalie's asking is, how do we create evolutionary we space? Right? What's the methodology for evolutionary we space? And it's too big of a question to go into fully here, but minimally, let's just say separate self can't create evolutionary we space. Impossible. Can't be done, right? Because separate self is this puzzle piece that's stumbling along and it's always going to clash with other puzzle pieces, right? But paradoxically, true self can't create evolutionary we space because the total number of true selves is one. So there's no we space, right? By definition, right? No we space, only one, right? So you can't create evolutionary we space without what I would call unique self and Andrew would call authentic self, right? I might also call it evolutionary unique self, meaning without that level of selfhood, right? You can't create evolutionary we space, right? In which there's a larger field, right? Where expressions were beyond true self. We have a glimmering of fragrance, a sense of the larger whole. We're omniconsiderate, for the sake of the whole, and yet we're individuating. And in that individuation, there's natural qualities, and those qualities create holistic hierarchies of many kinds, right? And when we do that, something enormously exciting happens. Something enormously, intoxicating happens. I never didn't want my teacher to be my teacher. It's a funny thing, right? In other words, when I was studying with a particular teacher whose name I won't invoke now, but who I dream about all the time. I mean, it's 42 years later, and I dream about him all the time, right? And he is this master of Talmud, and this righteous man filled with purity. And we parted ways in so many different ways, right? In other words, and I still feel in complete devotion to him. I don't want to displace him. I don't want to make us equal, right? You know what I mean? In other words, I'm in full devotion to him, right? Even though I've taken issue with so many things that he said, you know, in everything, in all the work we're doing, which is not particularly Jewish, right? We're trying to create a new universal grammar of value, which we completely object to. And yet I'm also completely surrendered to him, right? And in complete devotion to him, right? And miss him enormously. You know, and so we think that devotion is a pre-personal quality, right? Right? Devotion is like for the people who couldn't really get there. They weren't the real, but devotion is a beautiful quality, and we need to be in devotion to each other, and we need to be in devotion to our students, and we need to be in devotion to our teachers. And if we destroy the institution of teacher, right, and the murder of Eros, right, we destroy something essential, necessary for the very process of education on which reality is built. There is no culture without education. There is no education without a teacher. And a teacher's got to be transmitting something, or they shouldn't be teaching. It's not just facilitative. If we destroy that institution, we destroy culture, literally. And that's precisely what we're doing in the digitally mediated culture. We're actually destroying education. Education is becoming propaganda. And that distinction is a very, very important distinction my friend Zach Stein has written a lot about now, right? So if we're doing education in any way, education is real, the rest of teaching has to be real, right? And so we need to reclaim this possibility, or we literally destroy culture itself. So it's a big deal. It's not minor. It's at the very core of everything. And unique self and authentic self as methodologies, right? The sense of are critical. So like that, the beginning of that conversation.
Great, thank you. So we are soon coming to the end, but there is one actually very big question, but probably it's a good question to end this dialogue and then later think about if you want to continue, probably even in the next one, because there is one question from David, and he is asking, what lessons have you learned in your own spiritual communities, and how has it affected your beliefs on this topic? That's probably good for both of you to answer from your own perspectives.
Andrew.
Well, I think I need about 2 hours to answer that question. So since I don't have two hours.
Right, it's a hard one right at the end, right?
Yeah, it's impossible. But I mean, this, the singular thing that I've become aware of, the singular thing I've become aware of more than anything else is that as culture is evolving, our interpretation of spirit is evolving, and the context in which we relate to the concept of spiritual community also has to evolve also. So I'm still in a process of deep consideration about what it means for the concept of spiritual communion to emerge from a mythic context to a modern context to a postmodern context to a metamodern context. And I have some ideas about what this means, but I'm in a process of great discernment about it. I'm still in the process of figuring this out and coming to terms with what the clearest answer actually is to that question. So what I've learned is that in some of the ways I was holding my teaching position, my position as a guru and as a teacher, and some of the ways I was holding my students was outdated. It was not in alignment with the currents of cultural evolution. And that created dissonance because many of my students were in an evolutionary process that was calling them to transcend some of these mythic constructs. So the question that I'm very much immersed in is, what does the evolution of the triple gem look like? And the triple gem is the ancient idea of the teacher, the teaching, the community, the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. So I believe that the triple gem is the ultimate vehicle. It's a vehicle that I think animates and projects and gives rise to the power of spirit greater than any other structure or collective organism does. I'm convinced of that, the triple gem is the highest and greatest vehicle through which spirit can evolve. But the answer to the question of what does the triple gem look like and how does it precisely does it change when it makes the journey from a mythic context to a modern context, a postmodern context, the metamodern context is what I'm working on. And as soon as I've completely figured it out, I promise I'm going to tell everybody. But that's the most important question in my life.
Yeah. Yeah, received. I mean, and David, I appreciate the question, sweetheart. Right. I mean, I know David. He's beautiful, and it's a beautiful question. And, you know, Andrew and I, each in our own ways, are deeply in this meditation and, you know, in conversation about it. And in some sense, maybe we should do an entire dialogue just on that question to, you know, to flesh it through, because it really was the original intention of this dialogue, and we're getting to it, you know, beautifully. And it's beautiful that it went so perfectly today, you know, at the end. But let me just share just a moment or two. You know, I love state experiences personally, right? You know, I love state experiences, right? You know, the experience of just radical immersion, you know, in the sweetness and the utter goodness of spirit in this absolute way, right, is such a great joy, right? And, you know, for a number of years at the core of, you know, community, I placed the transmission of the realization of state experiences, right? So for example, we would do Friday night prayer. And I can't even describe to you the exquisiteness and beauty of it, right? It's indescribable, right? It's like, you know, people mock, you know, Christian versions of harps in heaven, you know, but actually they're not being idiots. They're actually alluding to something, as C.S. Lewis pointed out a number of times in his defense, right, of, you know, descriptions of harps in heaven, right? They're alluding to kind of an unbearable beauty, right? Unbearable in the best sense of the word. And, you know, I would lay down my life, right, literally, to transmit that experience, because I thought that the transmission of that experience was so, and transformative is not, it's too cheap a word, right? I can't capture it in the word transformative, but Andrew, you know exactly what I'm talking about, but it's so radical that you can never be the same again. Now, stay with me, friends, and it turned out I was wrong, right? In other words, I realized that I actually hadn't emphasized in the structure of the teaching the details of ethics, right? The utter details of what ethics means and how we talk to each other, how we check information, how we make decisions, right? The ethical structures of how processes happen, right? As the place, right, where the divine lives. And it's not, we had an ethical system and it was all good, but that's, we didn't emphasize it, right? We didn't, you know, emphasize this very deep ethos, right, at the center of the Dharma. And in a certain sense, I took it for granted. You know, I grew up, I swam in ethos, right? I grew up on a prophetic ethos. That was a given to me, right? And I wanted to take it the next step. And I now realize, and it's one of my great, great realizations, right, is that actually without everybody doing shadow work of some kind, right? I call it, you know, shadow work. Andrew calls it, you know, face everything, avoid nothing, right? And they're not quite the same thing, but different conversation, right? But in other words, without actually everyone doing shadow work, meaning not just let's have the teacher do shadow work, the teacher should always do shadow work, of course, but so should all the students, so should the entire community, without always doing ethical clarification. You know, the most ulterior motive of all is the ulterior motive of piety, right? Right? So without ethical clarification, state experiences don't hold. That state experiences are always meted, and this was John Wellwood's great point, Andrew, that you and I are both deeply familiar with when he wrote in his book, Psychology of Awakening. It's a great book, right? It's kind of gotten lost, and page 6 or 7, he distinguishes between waking up and growing up, right? And he says that the state experience is mediated through your experience of psychological maturity. It's a huge, huge understanding, right? And our friend Ken talks about it more in terms of structure stages of consciousness, and those are both true. And I talk about it in, you know, in terms of unique self. But the point is, right, I've got to clarify my ethos. I've got to have, you know, ecstatic state experiences. And then, you know, like my grandmother would say, "Gewein a mensch." You got to be a mensch, right? Meaning, in other words, it's about just a core decency in the way we exchange, in the way we gather information, in the way we check our motivation, in the way we check the ulteriorness. And if we don't have those processes in place, right, of a core ethos, it collapses. And so how do we actually create, you know, this new vision of community that Andrew and I are feeling towards, right, which embraces all of that? So let's hold there. That's a lot, but it's at least the fragrance of a conversation.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, both of you. And we are at the end of these 2 hours. It feels like there is so much more to say, so I'm very much looking forward to the next dialogues that will come up. We will announce the date a little bit later, and you will for sure all get our emails. And with that, thank you, Marc. Thank you,
everyone.
Andrew. And I will play a little bit of music.
Andrew picked the music. Let's give us some real, great music there. We need some music now, don't we? We need to dance. Get it.